Hi everybody, this is Dr. A with a urinalysis basics video. We're going to look at the microscopic examination. So the microscopic examination of urine. Now, urine sediment contains a variety of materials, and some of which are normal, some of which are abnormal. So it's important to learn how to identify both normal and abnormal constituents. Recognition of the abnormal constituents is very important in the diagnosis and treatment of various renal diseases, and their presence can also confirm abnormal findings from the physical and chemical test, which is another video about that in the list. White cells in an unstained urine sediment typically will appear as round granular cells, which are 1.5 to 2 times the diameter of red cells. White blood cells in the urine are most commonly neutrophils, meaning they are there to fight off an infection. Up to 5 white blood cells per high power field is commonly considered to be normal. The high power field is the 400x magnification field, meaning it's with the microscope, it's the field where the 40x objective lens is used in a 10x ocular. Greater numbers of white cells indicate pyuria, and so that is the presence of an inflammatory process somewhere along the course of the urinary tract or urogenital tract in a voided specimen, so we could pick up bacteria from the genital side of things. Pyuria is often caused by a urinary tract infection, and significant bacteria will be seen on a urine sediment slide preparations that indicate a need for a bacterial culture. This photo shows the white cells and the red cells. So we're going to look at the bigger ones here. You can see granulation in them. Those are white cells, and then these smaller ones here are going to be red cells, and we're going to talk about red cells in a second. So on this bottom portion of the photo, these larger ones are white cells, and then the smaller ones here are red cells. So red blood cells, up to 5 red blood cells per high power field is generally accepted as normal. An increase in the number of red cells in urine is termed hematuria, or blood in urine. It can be due to hemorrhage, inflammation, necrosis, trauma, or neoplasm somewhere along the urinary tract, or the urogenital tract if it's a voided specimen, meaning it could come from the genitalia, so it could be menstrual blood in a female also. Squamous epithelial cells are the largest cells seen in normal urine specimens. They are thin, flat cells, usually with an angular or irregular outline and a small round nucleus that's usually in the middle. Squamous cells are frequently found in low numbers in voided specimens, and they generally represent the contamination from the genital tract, and their main significance is as an indicator of such contamination. So lots of epithelial cells means contaminated specimen. Bacteria. This should not be present or only in trace amount due to skin contamination. So if you see also a lot of epithelial cells, squamous epithelial cells with bacteria, some with a little bit of bacteria, that could just be contamination. But the presence of large amounts of bacteria is an indicator of an active infection, a urinary tract infection, which could be located anywhere along the urinary tract, usually either in the bladder, which would be a cystitis, or in the kidneys, which would be a pyelonephritis. This picture here represents bacteria. You can see these little bitty dots line all of those scattered all over. Those are bacteria. And then yeast should not be present. Presence of large amounts of yeast, or really any yeast, is indicative of a yeast infection, and it usually comes from the genital tract. So you can see these, they're attached, they're budding. It can be hard to distinguish a yeast from a red cell, and it takes a trained eye to be able to tell the difference. One of the key differences is that yeast bud, whereas red cells do not. Highlandcast, so we're going to get into the cast. They are formed in the absence of cells in the renal tubular lumen. They have a smooth texture and a refractive index very close to that of the surrounding fluid, meaning they can blend and can be hard to detect. You need to increase the contrast to detect those. When they're present in low numbers, so 0 to 1 per low power field, a low power field is using the 10x objective with a 10x ocular, so it's 100x magnification. So when present in low numbers in concentrated urine of otherwise normal patients, Highlandcasts are not always indicative of any kind of significant disease, but greater numbers of Highlandcasts could be associated with proteinuria of renal or extrarenal origin, so either from glomerular disease or an overflow proteinuria such as in myeloma. This is what a Highlandcast looks like, and you can barely see the outline of it. It tends to blend into the background. They can be hard to pick up on. You have to really look at them. And again, usually if you can increase the contrast in the background, it helps to pick up for a Highlandcast. Cellular cast, they are often a result of a disease process such as ischemia, infarction, or nephrotoxicity, and those can cause degeneration and necrosis of the tubular epithelial cells. A common scenario would be the patient with a decreased renal perfusion, that means not enough blood flow to the kidneys, and oliguria, meaning they're producing only small amounts of urine, that is secondary to severe dehydration. That ischemic injury would result in the degeneration and sloughing off of the epithelial cells. And then the resulting casts often are prominent in urine produced following the rehydration with fluid therapy. So as the kidneys are rehydrated, it's flushing all of the stuff that stuck while they were being dehydrated. The restoration of the urine flow flushes all the casts out of the tubules. And then leukocytes can also be incorporated in those casts in cases of tubular interstitial inflammation, like in pyelonephritis. So this is a cellular cast. So you can see the outline of the cast, and then you can see the cells that are stuck inside of the cast. And then waxy cast, they have a smooth consistency, but are more refractile and therefore easier to see than the Highlandcast. They have squared off ends, whereas a Highlandcast tend to have rounded ends, as if they were brittle or easily broken. Waxy casts are found in chronic renal diseases, and they're associated with chronic renal failure. They occur in diabetic nephropathy, malignant hypertension, and glomerulonephritis. These are what waxy casts look like. You can see, so the straighter edges, a little bit more easier to see, more prominent. So those are pretty typical waxy cast. And that wraps up our microscopic video.